regular meeting of the Wetzel County Board of Education is called to order. We'll begin with an opening pledge of allegiance, which Mr. Castle will lead us in. I'll share an invocation after which anyone not wishing to participate may stay seated.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Father, thank you for blessing us and helping us tonight. We appreciate the opportunity to gather together to encourage one another as we make decisions that affect our students here in Wetzel County Schools. We pray that you give us wisdom and guidance that we might consider all things and make the best decisions we can to encourage the academic pursuits of our students. Help us and strengthen us, and we pray this through Christ's name. Amen. Amen. We'll let the record reflect that Mr. Yeager is on the phone with us, and that's why my phone is sitting there. I'm not checking my messages. Mr. Yeager is there on the phone with us tonight, not able to be with us in the building. First item on our agenda tonight are some recognitions. Unfortunately, Ms. Green is not able to be with us tonight, and so we've been trying to catch her from her all-state performance, recital performance, but we will get her as soon as we can. But we do have some other students that we want to honor tonight, All-State Thespians, and we want to congratulate them, and that's an area that's dear to me. And so Dan, you, Mr. Henthorne, I'm sorry, you are welcome to come up and share in this experience with us as well tonight. Their director and teacher is with us, and so we're glad you were able to make it to celebrate your students with us tonight. And I'll name them one by one, and we'll recognize them with certificate. And if you would, as you come up, then stay here for a photo. So Talon Chambers. I don't see Serenity Strother with us, but she was also, I believe she and Talon did a duet. Dan, you're welcome to talk a little bit about
Talon,
that.
Talon Chambers and Serenity were chosen throughout the state of West Virginia to present their musical duet in a showcase in front of the entire Thespian Festival on Saturday morning of our festival.
Here she comes.
And then I have three other students from Magnolia High School that they're all three freshmen. And they had there were three roles in our West Virginia contest play, and they were all freshmen, so I've got these girls for the next few years. And they, most schools get a couple of people named to All-State cast, but this year we, Magnolia, they chose all three of our students from Magnolia as All-State cast, and they were incredible in the play, so. And then we also have Briley. We also had Briley was second place in the state as the top tech student in the state. So she's only a freshman and was the second in the state. So.
So let's honor Briley Watkins. Never give a theater guy the floor, huh? Henry Shaw, is that correct? No, I apologize. Congratulations.
Back up a little bit, please. All right, and together, you all like each other. So. On three, one, two, three, one more, one, two, three.
Thank you, Oliver.
Thank you.
the next item on our agenda tonight are our delegations, and we appreciate the opportunity to hear from the public when they have things they want to bring before the board. It is my job as the president to follow our policy as it relates to those delegates. And you'll see that time on the board on the screens. That's, if you want to know why that happened, you can blame me. I am terrible at this. I admit it. I have been sitting in this seat for 2 years, and I owe it to the person who's going to sit here after me to do a better job. I don't like interrupting people. I don't like saying stop or those kinds of things. But I do need to be fair to everybody and follow the policy. So we've added an element to try to help me so that I'm not staring at a clock or my watch trying to guide through those things. And you'll know. So you're welcome to spend that 5 minutes addressing. Actually, you're supposed to address me according to policy as it comes. So please don't address other people in the room or other members. That's also part of our policy. And so with that said, I'm just going to go down the list. I know, Dr. Anderson, you were on our official agenda as well, but you're also listed on my sheet here. And so I'm just going to go down the sheet if that's okay. Jay, we're getting a lot of bounce back from you right now.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Maybe if you could.
Papers, I'll put those away.
Yeah, if you would, if you could just mute your phone maybe until you have something to share.
Just finish the 7th.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right.
So, Iris Isaac, wants to address the board about girls' softball. Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you.
First, thank you for having me. Believe me, this is the last place I thought I would be tonight. But I'm coming here as a citizen, as an aunt, a great aunt, and a grandmother, even though my grandchildren do not attend West County. I was quite surprised that there isn't a policy for discipline. But I think maybe you might want to approach that, then there could be some more consistency in the discipline. I'm here tonight for my great niece, which tells you I'm getting older when they're great, and for the students that are playing in the girls' softball. I do not personally know the softball coach, but I do know some of the assistants, and I know they get very little pay for the time that they really dedicate. And as we all know, it gets harder and harder to have volunteers to help. Not volunteers, I know they're paid, but they do help with that. And when emotions run high, mistakes can be made. And I'm not here tonight to disrespect anyone or to attack anyone's character. I am able to tell you I have made many mistakes. But I can admit that I made them because I'm an adult. And it is apparent that this situation has really got blown out of proportion. Mistakes were made. There were definitely two wrongs. But as my grandma told me, two wrongs does not make a right. These kids have been through a turmoil that none of us can imagine in the last 2 years with COVID. Things have been denied. There's schools, graduations. I mean, there's been so much. And I'm asking you guys to look at the punishment that this coach has received. And I think if you follow your heart, if you follow your common sense, this is excessive punishment for the crime. I know there's rules, and I try to follow them as hard as I can. And I know that someone in this position has felt disrespected and wants to use his or her position to let them know who has the authority. All in all, those are personal battles, and the kids and the assistant coaches are just pawns in this matter. So really, the only thing I'm asking you guys to do is follow your hearts. Ask yourself, is this truly worth this kind of punishment to lose 3 ball games and putting that extra pressure on the assistant coaches? And just follow your heart and do the right thing, because this is wrong, what is going on with the girls' softball. And I thank you all for your time and appreciate the effort to speak to you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, on our list of those who want to speak, Dr. Anderson, if you...
I serve Wetzel County through several roles. I'm a community member, a small business owner, a supporter of Wetzel County Schools, a spouse of a coach and former educator in Wetzel County Schools, but most importantly, I'm a parent of a student in Wetzel County Schools, and I have been for the last 18 years. I understand that children thrive in a consistent and structured environment. I understand educators thrive in an environment where professional development is accessible and encouraged. I appreciate and commend Wetzel County Schools for exploring options for professional development. However, the proposed Wetzel Wednesdays would create confusion and stress, especially for young students and students with special needs, as well as their families, including the families of teachers and school staff. Delaying the start of the school day by 1 hour would require children and many working families to wake much earlier from the typical school day so that their parent could take them to a caregiver so the parent could go to work, or the parent would have to report late to work. In both instances, it would be an added expense to that family, the expense of paying a caregiver or the expense of lost wages due to missed work hours. It shouldn't be assumed that a parent has a friend or a family member in close proximity to serve this, to provide the service every Wednesday. Inconsistency in an early morning routine elevates stress, even in the most resilient of children and adults. A late starting school day would affect many of our teachers and staff as well, as it's assumed that the school administration would not permit teachers and staff to have their own children in the school buildings unsupervised during these important and possibly confidential professional development meetings. A suggested solution: consider using 1 hour at the end of the school day on Fridays, or 2 hours at the end of the school day every other Friday. Managing childcare after school hours is often less disruptive for a family than doing so during the chaos of an early morning. Using the late afternoon time would provide a consistent school day start schedule for 4 consecutive days or 9 consecutive days. I and other parents are respectfully asking for you, our elected officials, to consider our input, hear our concerns, see our perspective. Allow our teachers to thrive by providing them a consistent plan for their professional development, but allow our children and our families to thrive by providing them with a consistent start to every school day. A second concern: the decision of the board administration to cancel all county high school after school events on the day of the optional invitation only academic award ceremony was unfair, unprecedented, and unnecessary. The decision was unfair to the students who were not invited to the optional invitation only academic award ceremony by denying them the opportunity to practice their sport on the afternoon of the ceremony, a privilege for which they worked, they earned. This decision was unprecedented. Until last Thursday, practices have not routinely been canceled solely because a few members were attending another school event. Athletes have attended the State Thespian Festival, math and science competitions, spelling bees, social studies fairs, financial aid seminars, young entrepreneurship conferences, youth and government conferences, band and choir performances and competitions, parades, and even special recognition presentations at board meetings. And yet their practices were not canceled for them to do so. This decision was unnecessary. Coaches could have done what they have done many times in the past: simply allow students who needed to leave be able to leave. They could have chosen to reschedule or even to cancel their own practices. The administration is doing a very good thing, the academic awards ceremony. But some bad decisions have been made in the process. The decision to cancel all county after-school events on the day of an optional invitation-only academic awards ceremony is unfair, unprecedented, and unnecessary. Thank you for the time to address you.
Thank you.
Chuck Clegg is on my list next.
I wish to thank the Board of Education and the superintendent for allowing me to come here and speak tonight. I've spent the last year and a half talking with students with type people inside the school system, people outside the school system, and concerned citizens, talking about what the future of Wetzel County can be, and what I would like to see us move towards consolidation in some areas to build a future with a better school system. I've also reviewed the school's 10-year plan, and those I've spoken with believe the philosophy of the board is the same as it has been for the last 50 years. Stay the course. Stay the course is not a way to lead, go forward. Look at the areas around us. Look at the other school systems, what the economic development of the oil and gas has done to improve the future. I'm only one man, and I can't change the direction of the Wetzel County school system. And I believe if I stand up and say something, maybe somebody else will stand up. I don't believe that I can change any of your minds in here about the future of the school systems, but the people listening and watching who I speak to over the next couple of years, maybe they will relay to you they want to change. They want people to move forward. Each of you are good people, and I bet you do the best you can see fit for what you're doing. And play it safe, take no political risk for today, tomorrow, or the future. In a short period of time, 3 new members will come on board. Perhaps then, the next, we can look at the 10-year plan again and say, maybe we can make some changes. Our schools meet, each school meets the needs of a single-A classification when it comes to sports. If we combined all 4 schools, we would still barely meet a single-A classification. We have dropped that much in the last 15, 20 years, and we will continue to drop if we don't add opportunity in this community for teachers, students, and people living here. Each year, the board puts together a 10-year plan. I ask those who were not amongst the education system, but also were asked to be part of it, if they talked about consolidation. To the person I spoke with, they said there was no speaking of consolidation. It was a non-starter. It was not to be spoken about. Now, on the other hand, I've talked to people who were in the administration and a part of that board, and they said we did talk about it. And the final 10-year plan didn't show anything on there where you did do anything. Clearly, with the group of educated people, both inside and outside the system, you did not find a way future to even discuss the possibility. This county's finances is very good. We don't owe much money of any kind that I know of, and we could build a system. Non-starter, if that's true, if they come out away from this thing with a non-starter attitude, then we have a very bad understanding amongst the board members. The students of Wetzel County deserve better. They need the same opportunity as other schools to have advanced math labs, advanced chemistry labs, TV stations, radio stations, Olympic-sized pools. Maybe with one Olympic-sized pools and different things, we could develop an Olympian sometime here in the future. But then we're not going to do it with the 4 schools we have now, because we don't have anything beyond the academics and the basic programs we have now. Some students would be better off if their curriculum was directed towards today's need in the employment world. School with broadcasting, TV, radio, curriculum. Meat cutters is very good, but if we can do that, we can also try and build an Olympic type system. You've done a good thing bringing back the training center, but so much more could be done with the training center and its crafts. They prepare today's workforce. Amanda McPherson put together a good foundation for a training center, but that training center needs to be 3 or 4 times bigger than it is. It has to offer more opportunities for students to go out there and learn how to work on an engine, how to build a house, how to do all the things that college don't offer, but we can in this county if we would do it. You have chosen to be part of the guiding force as members of the board and superintendent, but you may have forgotten responsibilities not to preserve a brick and mortar building or decide the future based on community politics or the dislike of the superintendent. You need to do it what's best for the students in the county. Now's the time, but we can't do it when the words in your mouth are non-starter. Thank you.
Next on my list, wasn't sure whether they wanted to speak or not, but they put down just in case, I believe it's, is it Dave Scott? I apologize if I'm not reading that right.
It's Robert and Marie Scott.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yes, I'm not going to get up and speak.
Okay, all right, thank you.
We're just here to support Coach.
I understand, thank you. And that is all my list then of delegates this evening. And I apologize for not saying this at the outset. Anything that's brought before the board, if it's on my agenda for tonight, then that subject matter can be addressed at that time. If it's not on my agenda, I'm not, and we are not allowed to talk about it at all. That's the law. And so just wanted to give you an understanding of that. We listen, we pay attention, we're hearing you, but we can't always address your subject matter because if it's not on my agenda, I'm legally bound not to do that. And so just a heads up on that. And if it is on the agenda, then we'll address it then. And thank you all again for sharing with us tonight. And thank you for respecting and helping me tonight. You think I'm being absolutely sincere about that. I appreciate so much. It's a lot easier on me to not have to say, can we wrap it up? It's hard. So thank you all for that. Next on our agenda is superintendent's information.
Okay, you have in front of you the Wetzel County School Study of West Virginia Standards for Effective Schools. You have the document for number 6, the frequent monitoring of student progress. I'm also going to be handing out to you the literature that was given to principals. There should be one for Mrs. Simmons and then one for all 5 board members here. We did a study at the principals meeting last Wednesday on effective standard number 6, frequent monitoring of student progress. And that, of course, deals with formative assessments that are used to measure student performance. It also talks about student performance that is used to guide instructional decisions and teachers monitoring student progress toward established instructional goals. The 3 articles you have 3 articles in front of you. The 3 articles you have, I just stapled them together for convenience sake. The first one is on progress monitoring within a response to intervention model. Well, Mrs. Fauna, you remember RTI. We don't call it RTI anymore. We call it WVTSS, West Virginia Tiered System for Support. There has to be an acronym for everything we do. But we really got into this article. We did a 3-2-1 teaching strategy with it as administrators here in the county and with the principals. And really dug this apart and talked about this article. We talked about good progress monitoring leading to better family engagement. And that is a really key piece for us in Wetzel County. We're trying to engage the families and get a hold of those harder to reach families and get them in. And we believe that if we had good progress monitoring and we could speak honestly with parents about where their students are and what they're doing and have really good data and talk about why we do the certain instructional strategies that we do, that would lead to better family engagement. We say that we found out that good progress monitoring leads to better differentiation for students. One size does not fit all. Progress monitoring, when done correctly, could improve the ability to differentiate and engage families in meaningful and positive ways. We like to begin with the end in mind in our instruction, and with progress monitoring, we can see what we need to do. We can visualize what needs to occur as a summative assessment, and we can begin with that summative assessment in mind, and we can inform instruction, and we can create instruction and curriculum that meets the needs of the kids. And that was with the first article. With the second article that you have in there, it's how educators can use student data to drive instruction. We did a strategy called Each One, Teach One with that group. And the big takeaways are that data-driven instruction creates a more supportive and constructive school culture. That there's a collaboration with all teachers, administrators, and district leaders, if it's done well, to implement necessary steps in each of our individual schools. And then you go to the fourth one, which was the easiest of the reads, and that is 4 benefits of monitoring student progress in the classroom. Usually I don't like to use .coms for research, but this is actually a really good .com, so we used it. It's teachstarter.com. And the 4 benefits for those are collecting useful data. As you go through, you'll see improving teacher instruction, ensuring achievement for every student, and identifying students at risk. So those are the 3 articles that we used for a multiple hour discussion and interaction. We actually did the strategies, acted like we were students, and did these strategies on Wednesday. And the principals now are tasked with taking this back to their teachers and working on that in their schools. We only have one more left, guys, and that's family engagement. And we talked about it's taken us all year to get through the seventh, but it's been a good study. And had a good laugh with Mr. Price today about these strategies and hoping we don't have to see them. That we'll internalize them so much now that we won't need to study them quite as much. And we will, at the next meeting, go over and really review family engagement. We started that discussion this morning in our staff meeting here at the county office. We had some very meaningful discussion, and we'll go over that with you at the next meeting. So there's that. Would like to talk about 100 High School TSA. I don't know how many of you saw this or heard about this, but they, for the past 2 years, have been first in the state, outstanding chapter. Now, this is beating schools the size of Clay County. This is beating schools the size of University High School, one of our biggest schools in the state. This year, 100 came in second. Well, I was thrilled. You know, when you're up against these big schools, they are not so happy. They came in second to University High School of all, I mean, here's one of the smallest schools in the state up against one of the biggest schools in the state, and they still came in second and only lost by 2 points. So kudos to 100 High School, to the Technology Student Association. The one of the advisors, Mr. Rex Rush, is the State Advisor of the Year. 100 has had a State Advisor of the Year for the past 3 or 4 years. So we're very pleased with the work that they are doing. We have many first places from 100. Long Drain ended up third in the state, Little Long Drain. We had many first places, and many of the students, both in the middle school and in the high school, are going on to nationals. So be looking for that. Go Hornets. The West Virginia Board of Education meeting on Wednesday, Mr. Price and I will be in attendance at that meeting to hear the formal report on the Shortline School Special Circumstances Review that you guys asked for and I asked for. And we will be asked to answer questions possibly and give statements about findings and next steps at that board meeting on Wednesday morning. So that's where Mr. Price and I will be during that time. The Academics Award Banquet has been brought up this evening. We had it 9 through 12. It was a smashing success. We'd like to thank Tammy Chambers and Chrissy Bowers for all the excellent work that they did toward that, and make sure that we know that tomorrow night we are on for grades 5 through 8. That is all I have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item then on our agenda is superintendent's recommendations, and the first one is to approve the minutes from the regular meeting from March 28th. Is there a motion?
So moved.
It has been moved to accept the minutes from the regular meeting on March 28th. Is there a second?
I'll second.
It has been moved and properly seconded. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? And it will be delayed all night, by the way. Next item on the agenda then are personnel matters. I can see those listed for you there. Board members, are there any questions concerning personnel matters that would require an executive session this evening? Not hearing any motions for that, then is there a motion in relationship to these personnel matters?
I motion for approval of the superintendent's recommendations as outlined under the personnel matters.
I second.
It has been moved and properly seconded. Again, I'll ask for any questions at this point. Not hearing any, all in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Next item on the agenda are routine matters. There's some chaperone lists there for us to consider. Also, the contracts for several different projects among a couple of our schools that need our approval this evening. Are there any questions regarding any of the routine matters?
Can I say something, Mr. Price?
Absolutely, Mr.
I just wanted to point out the construction project at Payton City Elementary. That is not just for the gymatorium. If you look at the description there, that's the cost. Since we combined our bid for the HVA
HVAC project was included in that bid. The sprinkler system, that building, I believe it might be our only building that's not sprinkled.
Correct.
The elevator, all those are grouped in with that total cost. I'm very pleased with the bids that came in for that. Mr. Doty was in there with me. Had pretty good turnout for that. You know how it is right now with everything from roofing joists to gasoline to cheeseburgers cost more. So we didn't know what kind of bids we were going to get. So the competition was good. The estimates we put in, this came, the HVAC portion came in about $320,000 under budget, under what we estimated. The sprinkler system came in about $133,000 under, and the gymnasium part came in about $187,000 under. So very pleased with, and surprised, I guess I'd say, with what came out of that. So we're pleased with that. Then the roofing project was the same thing. We had pretty good participation with that. This is for the K-1 project in Martinsville School. So pleased with our prices there, and we're under budget and moving forward with them. If we just need approval, since it requires anything over $100,000 for project board approval.
And I do appreciate the clarification, because sometimes we've been setting aside money over multiple years to do this, so that we weren't just pulling all of it out at one given moment. And if anybody has ever been down there in that building, you understand it. There's some ADA issues, there's size issues, there's use issues. I mean, it's the only school in the county that doesn't have a separate gym and cafeteria. They're sharing the same space, and if you've ever been in it, you can imagine a basketball court. The top of the key crosses the half-court circle. So that's how small that space is, and it's the only space they have. So this has been a long time coming, and so I appreciate all the work that all of you have been doing over the past several years to get those projects going. Board members, any other questions as it relates? Go ahead, Mr. Kessler.
Do they anticipate starting this relatively soon, like after school's out? Or
The HVAC part of that project, the goal is to get that done, before school starts. Again, same thing. We've been down this road before with short line, and where's the wood? We did a nice job with that project. We're planning on doing the same thing with this one. We put everything in place to make that happen. The other project won't be as much of a disturbance. That's not going to be done before school starts.
Yeah, I understand that. The HVAC is going to be on the same wavelength as out of short line. If they don't have it finished by the time school starts, they're going to do alternate cooling methods and everything like that.
Yes.
Yeah, I think the only thing that they're thinking about is maybe the boiler pumps like they were at short line, but other than that, they think everything's going to be on schedule.
But just in case, they're prepared to do what
they'll just put the old pump back in until the new ones show up, and they'll swap them out whenever the new stuff shows up.
Because I think that happened out of short line.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. That was the only thing we waited on, was boiler pumps. And actually, they showed up probably about 4 days before school started, so we were good.
The K-1 roof project, the same way. It's going to be tough to get it done before it starts. They're hoping
maybe they might finish up a week to a week and a half after school starts, but it's just going to be little stuff, so it shouldn't be a big disruption.
Have the locations been chosen for Energy Express?
Yes, Long Drain School, and we're going to have the Peyton City High School.
High School, okay.
Any other questions about either the construction work or any of the other routine matters? Mr. Yeager, you have any questions as it relates to those things? I don't want to leave you out here.
No, I do not.
Okay. Not hearing any further questions, is there a motion as it relates to routine matters?
I move to approve the routine matters.
It's been moved to accept the routine matters. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
It's been moved and properly seconded to accept the routine matters. Again, I'm asking one last time. Are there any questions from the board? Not hearing any, all in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. The next item on our agenda is the Wetzel Wednesday's question, and we're being asked tonight by the superintendent to approve Wetzel Wednesday's for staff development and professional learning community effective beginning the 2022-2023 school year. And as we've been, were shared with us last meeting, that that would basically, in under the proposed manner of doing that, would be an hour delay every Wednesday. Give you an opportunity if you want to share anything further with us, Mrs. Wells, as it relates to that, or are you ready for just questions from the board?
I'm ready for questions from the board.
Okay, just want to do it
that's
that
fair.
Way. Okay.
Because you guys got the Brooklyn Bridge and you have all the questions and answers and all that, so I think that's fair. Yeah.
Okay. So, board members, I'll open it to y'all before. I've got a handful of questions, but I'll let you. I'll give anybody else first turn here.
But you taking first turn and
nope.
we'll cover whatever.
Oh, yeah.
I've got questions too.
Okay, well, and we get it, right? We get it. You're sometimes you're sitting in these seats and you're putting everything in the balances and you're trying to weigh it all and determine which way those scales go. And sometimes it's not as obvious as others. Sometimes there's lots of factors that make the balance of those scales harder to address. My questions are, or concerns maybe, so just did rough math, and if I'm not mistaken, there'd be, roughly 38, if my memory serving correctly, about 38 Wednesdays throughout the school year.
All right.
And then I did some rough math. So that's basically 5 instructional days that our students will miss. And so you're at 180. If you use 5 NTID days, you're down to 175. If we do an hour delay every Wednesday, we're down to 170 instructional days. And that, to me, that's a concern.
It's not a good optic, you're right. It's not a good optic, but it's a little deeper than that. There's a lot more that goes into that, and there's instructional time, accrued instructional time. Mr. McPherson is kind of our local expert on that because he keeps track of that on a daily basis. And I think you can explain it best, and if you don't want to, I can.
No, I can explain. I'd be glad to.
That's your thing, yeah.
So we do track instructional time and how much time we bank every day. And we bank the least in our high schools because they require the most amount of time to make an instructional day. Our elementaries require actually a half hour less to be considered an instructional day. So when we looked at how much time we have, that's where that NTID comes from. That's where the PD day comes from. So when we first talked about it, I was nervous, but I went and ran it through, and we will be okay. We will still, if the State Department ever does ask us to come up with how our accrued time was used, we would be square with the house still.
Even with the NTID days?
Yes, and still have time for 2 hour delays.
Well, and I'm not, I guess my concern.
It's not a good optic if you don't know. It really isn't. Yeah.
Well, my concern wasn't necessarily that we wouldn't have enough time accrued to handle it, just the fact that we're taking it away, because in the other year that would have been used as instruction time. And that, it's just something of value I think we have to at least consider in the equation.
We do, and I just hope that you would also consider the value of strengthened instructional strategies and strengthened pedagogy from the hour a day and the PLC time, the collaboration that we would have from that as well, so we could be more effective, more efficacious, if you will.
And I guess I'll just ask it because it's been the one of the things that when we've heard from parents and folks privately and or was any consideration given to anything but this hour early approach? Is it even feasible to consider? Because I get that, by the way, you probably, if you're using help with your children, you probably already have that secured for a 3:15 dismissal as opposed to securing, so I get that.
I get it, too. Fair. I don't think people realize how much I get it.
I'm
raising 2 children.
No, I get it. No, I'm trying to get an opportunity here to
yes.
open that discussion up.
And yes, sure and I do understand, and it's tough. Mornings are tough. Mornings are tough on a good day. We did consider that. We do have concerns. We brought it up at both the principal's meeting and in our staff meetings. If we do the early outs, that leaves our high school students who have after school activities waiting an hour. And some of our schools are out in the county and we have kids who live up to 20, 25 miles away from the school. and they have cars, or they have friends with cars, or they're at the school unsupervised for that hour while they're waiting for coach or, you know, whatever, that time to be over so that teacher can be with their students then when school is dismissed. So there's that time that we would lack some supervision, or that kids could possibly be in vehicles and not, it's a lot more seamless, for us with student safety to go from dismissal into the school activity than to have that break. And, you know, not always, sometimes practices do start later, and we have that anyway. But this would assure that we would not have to worry about that every Wednesday or whatever day we would choose to do the hour out. There would be supervision. It would be a seamless move of kids from one activity to the next. There also is a tendency to have, we would have, I don't know how to say this, I'm just going to say it. We would have better attendance to professional development in the morning than in the afternoon sometimes, because it's much easier. Doctor's offices are not open at 8 in the morning. However, they are open in the afternoon. It makes total sense to me, and I can see why that they would want to use that time for that possibly. Now, would everyone do it? No, but it's something we had to consider if we want the most bang for our buck with attendance at those sessions. We want our teachers at those sessions. And as a parent of young children, you can't pick and choose when your doctor's appointments are. So those were the things that we took into consideration. I'm not the only one with young children in the county office and among the principals group. And those were the kind of things, but we did consider those things. One thing that was brought up from one of the unions tonight, I meet with my unions prior to board meetings. Most of the time, in the winter, we had some difficulty with that. But we got back on today, and they said, you know, please mention that they would like for us to consider maybe once a month to do this and add those hours up and do it once a month as opposed to doing it every Wednesday. So I promised them I would definitely share that with you guys when you were asking your questions tonight.
On the once a month,
mm-hmm.
Once a month just for an hour?
It would be no half a day,
half a day.
For half a day. It would be all those Wednesday, the hours added up. They asked for that as to be an option. They asked that I share that with you. So I said I would.
Alex, you say that again, please.
Okay.
You'll make it, because I'm close.
Yes,
please. So basically, the question would be, Mr. Yeager, would be maybe a different option would be to do once a month, do a half day early dismissal, mm-hmm. where they would have the whole second half of the day once a month to do the very things that they're talking about doing 1 hour
instead of the weekly.
Right, correct. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
That was just asked.
Once a month, would have to be in the afternoon, I would imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So, but I promised I would mention that, so.
Okay, I'll
go
a couple different things. When we first discussed this, I had my teacher hat on. Having taught 37 years in the county, I had my teacher hat on because that's what I did. And I thought it was the best thing it's ever heard of, because talking with teachers right now, one of the biggest problems is there's so much more thrown on you to help improve, don't get me wrong,
right.
But there's no time. Mm-hmm. And especially with our lack of substitutes and having teachers cover on their planning periods, they don't even have that time anymore.
You're right.
And trying to do everything and retain teachers is getting scary, mm-hmm. because we have people. It breaks my heart when I see seasoned teachers that I know are excellent that say, if I could get out, I would get out. There's just too much. So we need something to give them some time to do all this that we're asking of them. So that was me wearing my teacher hat. Mm-hmm. Then a couple people contacted me, and I put on the parent hat. If my kids were still in school, how would it be? Mm-hmm. And then I looked at it very differently than I had. I don't think moving into the afternoon is going to be good for more than just high school kids and cars, but I mean, it's affecting theater groups and choral groups and a lot of other things too, not just sports. It's affecting a lot. And for some parents to come in and, or if kids to ride home in the bus and the parents have to bring back in an hour, again, I think that would cause a lot of conflict. People have said, well, see what Marshall County says, because they've been doing this for a while. Well, you get mixed reviews, just like we get here. I talked to some teachers that thinks it's the best thing ever because they can get some stuff done. Truthfully, when you just mentioned the half-day thing that the unions are mentioning, I'm looking at that thinking, well, you'd get the hours. It would only be one day out of a month that would be messed up. So maybe there's some things there too. I've also had elementary teachers contact me saying they would hate not to have reading first thing in the morning, although they could still have it first for when students came, but you know, it would have to be a set schedule so that they're still getting that. We don't want them to lose it. Many people know me as a science person, but I was a big math person for a while. And no, I don't want to see science done away with because we're having that hour. But at the same time, I know they've got to get the math and the English language arts in. So those are just the thoughts that have been going through my head.
Did we have any response? I ask you to check with other counties that do this. Did you have any response from them about what their problems were with it, or?
I did get a response.
I'm not trying to put you on the spot.
Oh, no. You asked me to do it, and I did. Okay. I reached out. In the Eastern Panhandle, they've had very little problem with it. There were some issues with after-school activities and that sort of thing. They seem to have worked through those at this point. Marshall County said the exact same thing, that at first it was a tough road, and you know, parents had to get their schedules straightened out, and there were some heartache during that time. But they said they've done it for so many years now, and it's very routine, and that it's working very well. So it starts out with growing pains, and then it ends up doing. They end up doing well, and they end up thinking it's valuable time. So.
And if we did that, and some parents drop their kids off at school early, what could we do about that? I mean, some people will say, well, they're at the building, I'm going to drop my kids off. Is there somebody supervising them or no?
We would work with those parents. We would never turn a kid away, ever. This is the time for teachers, though, to be into professional development and working. We would not encourage that, but we certainly would not turn a child away. And if we had to work individually with parents, we would definitely do that. We talked about that at the principal's meeting. So
there's a, you, we don't want a whole wholesale group of people coming in, but there's still, you know, if somebody really gets in dire straits.
We would never turn a child.
Right.
That's not what we're in the business about. No. Right.
We had a grant 1 year, and it's been quite a while ago, and it was an after school grant that paid to have somebody at least I know at the school I was at, I don't know about the whole county. For children whose parents got off work late or whatever that we did. I don't know if anything like that's available or not.
And it's definitely worth looking into, and some of that stuff was talked about. We talked about using other personnel besides teachers to do those sorts of things. We've talked about having student groups for leadership to come in and help with the younger children. A lot of things have been discussed and are definitely worth looking into, but we would never turn a child away, Mr. Castillo, right?
Well, I didn't expect so. And this is, maybe I'm speaking out of turn. This is not set in stone right now. This is the plan and that's it, right?
That's why I brought it to you guys.
Well, yeah, but what I'm saying is if we approve it for late start or whatever, what are we, is that the proper term, late start?
Yes,
or
yes, delayed start.
That there might be some, there might be some tweaking of the system to accommodate people that,
I've learned in education that everything gets tweaked all the time.
So
I want to be very adamant, though, that hour is a week is very important.
Oh, I understand.
And I want it, you know, my particular preference is in the mornings, but that doesn't mean that I'm so rigid and that I would not look at it differently if something was presented that was workable and doable.
There's
a lot that goes into plans.
I could see us approving this, but with the understanding that there could be modifications to it. Does that sound?
Who could make those modifications?
What's that?
Who could make those modifications?
The administration.
Okay.
Not the
teachers,
board.
Administration.
The people that are in the trenches.
In the, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, teachers,
people,
administration.
People that actually have to deal with that.
Okay.
And all we're basically doing is approving or not approving the framework, right? And then the nuts and bolts are.
I think procedurally what we've been presented, and I realize our agenda doesn't necessarily outline every detail, but I think what we're being presented today is a request to approve a 1 hour delay every Wednesday for the 2022-2023 school year.
Because that's what Wetzel Wednesdays are, and that's what we presented
right.
to you.
So procedurally, if you're asking, I don't think you can approve it and then say with the caveat that we may make adjustments here or there. I think you either you motion to move it forward to vote, or you don't.
And I think that would make it a lot easier
and then
for
you,
parents.
And if you don't, either you can approve it, you vote it down, or not do anything, and it would just be off the agenda for tonight anyway. If it was declined, I suppose then, if we're giving the feeling that a different approach is more suitable to the board, they could come back to us with another agenda item. I don't think you can approve it with the idea that, well, maybe we'll have to be some flexibility here or there. That's not really a solid foundation. I think.
I mean, we do have to be flexible, but we can't be flexible to the point where parents don't know what's expected, teachers don't
right.
know what's
you're
expected.
You're going to do that. You're going to do that because that's what you do in education.
Right.
It's just nature of the of what you have to be able to do in education. There's always that moment where you've got to address those things. But
right.
I think from if you're asking us to approve something tonight, what we would be approving or not approving is the what you asked us of,
exactly.
and that is that 1 hour delay on Wednesdays.
Mm-hmm.
And then if adjustments would be made, then my feeling from a procedural standpoint is that you would have to come back to us
that works for me.
With a change.
As long as I know.
That's my best understanding of Robert's rules and policy.
Mrs. Cooley, you still have children in the school system. I know they're not the real young ones, but you still do. So I'm sure you've actually talked to some other parents too about this. And what are your feelings?
Truthfully, I think change is difficult. But everyone I have spoken to, the morning would be easier because of the after-school activities. But that aside, what I've been sitting wondering is what is more beneficial. And here being, not being in the education field, this is where I don't know, is 1 hour that I don't exactly feel like they're going to get a full hour. Students are going to show up early. Things are going to happen. Versus 4 hours once a month. But then you run into the problem of possible attendance issues. I don't know which one is better.
May I say something? My
Absolutely.
Teachers work miracles in 45-minute periods.
I know that.
With kids, I am 100% confident that my teachers can work miracles in an hour a week.
Right. I keep thinking about myself. If I'm in the midst of a project and then having to stop and then have to go back and restart, it becomes difficult.
I understand.
And just to completely change... Not change the subject, but change the route here. In the questions and answers, if there was a 2 hour delay,
mm-hmm.
that one throws me for a little bit of a loop because it says that it would be canceled. What would the actual start time be? Because I'm going to tell you, as a parent, if it was to be approved for the mornings, my brain says Wednesday school starts at 9 o'clock. You put a 2 hour delay. I'm not sending my kid to 11.
Well, that's why we put this out. If there's if needed, announcements will be made through all of our communication channels if there's a 2 hour weather delay. If we have a 2 hour weather delay on a Wednesday, Wetzel Wednesdays will be canceled for that week. They would come at 10 instead of 9, and they would not lose further instruction.
I would strongly suggest making it a 1 hour delay because I think that that's opening up for.
If the weather lets
right.
us, because if the weather doesn't, we have to do 2. If the weather's that bad, and we are, I meet regularly with the National Weather Service. I didn't realize as part of being superintendent that I had to meet with the National Weather Service, but I do. And they tell us, they give us parameters of when this front's coming through, this front's coming through, and we have to make decisions based on what we know from the National Weather Service. And we meet with Pittsburgh, and then we meet with Charleston, and then we meet with Beckley, and it's crazy. So, Blacksburg, actually, not Beckley, Blacksburg. So it's just...
Okay. Okay.
But if 2 hour delay, if that's what we feel with the front coming in, we'll have to do 2 hour delay for the safety of the kids. But I understand, and if we can do a 1 hour delay, we can look into that. We're allowed to do a 1 hour delay if we want to, if it's what's safest for kids.
I would at least definitely include the start time because right. mine would have been an hour late.
So include the start time and the frequently asked questions. Okay.
Yes.
We have a 2 hour weather delay yes. on a Wednesday. Okay, cancel for that week. School would start on, okay.
Yeah, because my brain is just going to automatically say school starts at 9.
Okay.
So if there's a 2 hour delay, my kids are late.
Okay.
At the last time we discussed this, I would have jumped on board 100% for Whistle Wednesday mornings.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll be honest, after talking with people, thinking it through, mm-hmm. thinking the problems, I think the idea of a half day would give a continuous amount of time for teachers to work on things and would make it easier for parents and students.
Okay.
Board members, any other questions?
Yes.
Okay. I've been
and
you've been great. I appreciate it. You're good.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I absolutely can hear you. You've got the floor.
Okay. Mrs. Wells.
Yes, sir.
Marshall County has been doing this for a number of years. Do they think it has they've had academic growth because of it?
The people that I've talked to do feel that way, yes.
Okay. My second question, this is not an option for teachers. This is you will do it, correct?
Yes, sir. It's part of their work day.
You don't have the option to say, I'm not going to participate. I'm just going to stay in my room.
That's right. I think you were here the night I handed out the plans. Yes, and the weeks are already planned. Yeah.
Yeah. The answer to your question, Mr. Yeager, was yes, it would be mandatory, from what
okay.
Mrs. Wells was saying.
Yeah.
Is the start time for all schools still 7:30 a.m.?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so everybody will be expected to be there at 7:30 a.m.
Yes, sir. Teachers, not kids.
Teachers and staff members bringing their children to school with them.
No.
The answer to that was
is that a no?
Yes, not permissible.
Okay. All right. That satisfies all my questions then.
Okay. Board members, any other questions? Anything left? I'm like you. When I first heard it, and by the way, I might be the only one in the room who was a parent sitting in Marshall County when they put it in motion. I was sitting in meetings. We lived there when they put it in motion. That was been 15 years
ago
almost.
That's a long time.
So I was that parent sitting in that classroom hearing this proposal and wondering, what's all this going to be like? I was also a parent who's very privileged and blessed to be able to handle whatever they did, and so I admit that others would struggle with what was easy for us to handle. I'm going to throw one more thought in here that I've had since you introduced this to us was I'm just thinking about the last 2 years and are we really ready to? I mean, we haven't even had a normal school year yet. And are we really ready to now, is this the time? Is this the time to introduce an entirely new schedule, daily routine, after 2 years of...
We've also had 2 years of teachers going from heroes to being mocked and abused, and they don't have the time to do the things and the professional the professional time to honor their craft and to do what's right by kids. So yeah, it's been a tough 2 years for everyone.
I get it.
But I honor what it is to be a person who has dedicated their life to human growth and development, who are professionals, and need that professional learning time, and the present state of what the legislature permits us to do is not giving us the time. And you charged me with growing this county academically. And that, and my principals and my county office staff has worked all year to present to you a really quality product. And like I said earlier, my teachers in 45-minute increments, and some in less than that because they teach younger kids and they have to change activities every 15 minutes because of the age of the kid, they create miracles. They perform miracles in 45-minute periods with kids, not teachers. So certainly professionals with other professionals can do this in an hour, and it can be quality.
And I have no concerns or qualms about that.
Right.
Those are not my issues. I have no doubt that if you gave teachers 30 minutes,
mm-hmm.
they would do incredible things with that 30 minutes. That's not really it. In my challenges or thought processes, that's not part of the equation at all.
It is, but it's not. You're right, and I understand that. You're trying to give us all the angles, and I totally appreciate that. I can't stand a yes man. I hate a yes man. So I'm glad that you're asking these questions. However, I would not be doing my job backing professional educators. They are professional educators. If I did not value their opportunity for professional development.
Okay. Any other? Go ahead.
I'll be the devil's advocate. Did anybody among the professional staff, principals, et cetera, did anybody voice any concerns about it? Were they pretty much 100% behind this?
My staff can help us with that. We talked at the principal's meeting and gave them every opportunity at the last meeting, and they felt that the mornings, due to the absenteeism, that sort of thing, and to the consistency and the efficacy of this, this was the way that we needed to go. Yeah, we did. We had a long conversation.
Okay, I want to be for what they are there for.
And I'm sorry. Did you?
I'm thinking. I know you can see my wheels. I'm just curious if we were to pull the teachers, the ones actually in the trenches, doing the work, the ones that are going to be the ones in the professional learning, what's more beneficial to them? I just keep thinking about the fact that I know how frustrated I get if I'm in the midst of a project and have to stop. Even in the midst of a conversation, it's you're brainstorming and having to stop, and that momentum can be lost.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of would really like to hear from them. I am all for the professional learning. It's a matter of, to me, figuring out which one is more beneficial.
Well, I understand that.
And if I understood you at the beginning, that the association, when they wrote to you...
Yes, well, they didn't write to me, they talked to me personally.
Or however, they communicated with you, mm-hmm. that they...
they thought we...
They at least suggested that
right.
that 4 hours bunched together once a month, to them, was...
That was one person, but yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
No, I didn't know whether that was
a representation.
And
that person was representing other people.
Okay.
She was representing other people.
That's why I'm just trying to understand that position. Any other questions?
Just one very quickly.
Absolutely.
Concerning the questions for the teachers unions coming to Mrs. Wells. So are the teachers unions supportive of this? Since they mentioned they would rather have a 4 hours once a month instead of an hour once a week.
Well, Mr. Yeager, interestingly enough, this whole idea of having a weekly time came to me from our first meetings with the teachers' unions at the beginning of the year. It was mentioned by one of the association leaders. And so we started developing that this year, and we decided as a group of administrators to go with the hour due to the things that I told you. But yes, this idea originally came to us from those ranks. Now, what would I tell you that right now, I think they're 100% behind staff development and they're behind the idea, but But I think that they are in different places when it comes to the time.
Can I say something?
Okay.
Yes, you may be.
You guys keep throwing that 4 hours. No, we're going to get 4 hours. As soon as we can dismiss is 12:05, 12:15, 3 hours max. So I just,
well, I mean,
yeah, I know. I'm just, I'm happy that's splitting
hairs. I get it. So you'd be getting an hour less. If you moved it that way, you'd get an hour, you know.
If we delayed this until the 19th, would that be a detriment?
That's up to you guys.
This is not something that has to be.
What do you want us to do? I guess I would need more direction from you about where we go, because we've worked so hard on this, so I need to know exactly where it is you guys want me to go with.
I'm just throwing out a possibility.
Right. And that's fine. I mean, that's your all's responsibility as a board.
Well, now you're talking procedure. You can, with anything on an agenda, you can motion to approve it. You can take a motion to table it. If you just table it, it moves it automatically to the next agenda. You can table it with a set date. You can do it that way if you're not ready. And if the majority of the board is not ready to make a decision on it and they agree with your motion to table, then we can do that. If the majority of the board's ready to vote on it tonight, then that motion can be entertained as well. So any motion as it relates to the agenda item can be entertained.
What would be the benefit of tabling it? Would we survey people to get more information? Would we survey the unions to get more information? I mean, if we're just going to table it to put it off, I don't see the sense in tabling unless there's something that we're going to do differently between now and the next meeting.
If it is tabled, I would request some sort of survey. Whether we're surveying individual our teachers, or if we're surveying
parents?
No. The groups that you spoke with today.
Unions?
Thank you.
Associations. They're not
associations.
Okay. State of West Virginia does not allow unions, so
yes.
Associations.
Either way, if we're doing that, then I would like, if we are tabling, if it were to be tabled, I would request a survey. And my feeling is I'm leaning that way just because it's the teachers that over the past year have been asking for help. And we're wanting to offer this help, but I feel like we need to hear their voice and how they want it.
So that's up to them. I'm not saying I'm good. I almost said I'm not going to do your job for you.
Well, I was waiting for someone else to make a comment.
You know, if you want a motion towards any of those ends, I will entertain any motion as it relates to any of those things. So if you ask for a table, a motion to table, and request that teachers be polled as it relates to this matter, then you're free to make that motion. And if it gets seconded, we'll vote on it. If it doesn't, it doesn't.
Which I am perfectly happy to do. I just am not used to doing the last comment.
I understand. But I have no further questions. No further questions, Mr. Yeager?
No further questions.
Okay. So the floor will entertain any motion as it relates to this agenda item.
I move that we table the item for Wetzel Wednesdays until the following meeting, April 19th. And during that time, if we could survey our professional staff to see what would be most beneficial to them.
Before that motion is seconded, I will acknowledge that, as I mentioned to the board prior, I will not be here on April 19th. I am and unable to be at all. I can't be by phone or in any means. And if you desire for me to be here, then I would suggest maybe you amend your motion to the next meeting after that, which is May...
No, April?
No.
No, because that is the second meeting.
Okay.
This month. And so it would be May, what's the second meeting in May? It's gonna have a calendar in front of it.
Does that feel monkey wrench in the works to any extent?
That would be May 9th.
May 9th. So my suggestion would be to you, and you don't have to have me here, by the way. I understand that it's, I have to be away, but if you think all five of us should be here for that, then that would require for you to amend your motion to be for May 9th.
May 9th would give Mrs. Wells time to gather the information and data for time.
Is there any reason that it would have to be done sooner? In that case, I'd like to amend my motion to the May 9th meeting.
So it has been moved that we table this issue into the May 9th meeting to allow for time for a polling or survey of the teachers to determine what their thoughts are as it relates to early delays or early dismissals and how that would function. Is there a second?
I second it.
Has been moved and properly seconded to table this issue upon the completion of that survey for the May 9th meeting. So it's been moved and properly seconded. Are there any questions as it relates to the motion?
Who will construct the questionnaire?
So.
Mr. McPherson's already in the process of doing
that. So we would have to leave that to Mrs. Wells.
I'm just making sure that before I go under the bus again.
So it has been moved and properly seconded. Any other questions as it relates to that motion?
Is the questionnaire just going to say, or are we leaving it up to your discretion? It's just going to say, yes, we want it, no, we don't, or, you know, are there going to be...
I don't know. I'm waiting for this motion. I think
it's been clearly stated what we're asking
for. Yeah.
We want to know, do the teachers like the idea of a delayed approach, 1 hour on Wednesdays? Would they prefer to have a half day once a month? I think that's what we're looking for from this survey.
Exactly how I would word it at this point,
right.
I don't know. But I think you're right. They have three options pretty much. Correct. Yeah.
That would be, so that is the motion on the floor. Again, are there any other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And I am nay. I was ready to answer this, so anyway. Irrelevant, but just to vote honestly. So that has been tabled, approved to be tabled to the May 9th meeting. Thank you all for weighing all those things in the balance, and we'll wait for this report to come back to us. And once you give ample time for that. If you could share that maybe and then in the May 9th packet for us, the results of that. Next item on our agenda then is the treasurer's report. And so, Mr. Lancaster, you've been patiently waiting for us. Thank you. The only thing I have,
I have two items on the agenda. There are no transfers and increase in the budget tonight, so I don't need any approval of that.
Okay.
Just asking for approval for payment of bills for the month of March, which you have already received and have. That's all I need.
Is there a motion?
I so move.
It has been moved to accept the Treasury report, including the payment of the bills for the month of March. Is there a second?
I'll second
that.
Amy, grab it just before you, Jay.
That's all right.
And
I'll let her have it.
Are there any questions relating to the payment of the bills for March? Not hearing any. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? The motion carries. Next item on the agenda is the acceptance of our annual audit report, which we're required to do each fiscal year. Mr. Lancaster, any other information you want to share with us as it relates
to
that?
Yes, briefly, I'd like to read this entire booklet to you tonight.
Page one, here we go.
We had our annual audit, you know, the public school system, we're required to be audited annually. Matter of fact, we're about to bid out those services again. We are under a 3-year contract, we're going to do it again. It's no fun, it's a pain in the neck for everybody that's involved, but it's required, and it kind of, say, keeps us on our toes because we got to do things right. We have rules to follow that aren't as, it's not as easy as just going to Walmart and buying what we want to buy. We have to follow the rules. So I'd like to say, if you turn to page 91, and I'm just going to quickly say, I'm very proud of the people that I work with in regards to finance, because once again, we have no findings. You can see on here that there's the internal control over financial reporting. Were there any material weaknesses identified? The answer is no. You can turn the page just to speed it up to 92. There were no findings on the financial statement audit. No findings on our major federal awards program. So very pleased, very proud of the people I work with. I think we have really good financial staff, and we work well together. I hope that continues that way. I think it will. The only other thing I want to point out, I considered not even mentioning it, but in the back of your book, there is a letter that the auditors, they always send a letter to the members of the honorable board members and management. It's called a management comment letter. Things that weren't big enough to be a finding, but they put in the letter. There are only two items they put in there, and my goodness, as much as they look, I'm pretty pleased to have only two items here. One was that they're in the personnel file, their sample. There was one that did not have a signed contract. The contract was in there, but it wasn't signed by the employee. But that goes back to
2001.
So they look. The other item on there, there were bonds.
I missed it. Sorry.
I'm training them, though. We'll get them around. The other item on there is bonds filed and recorded with the county clerk. That's a COVID thing. We always, we have superintendent, myself, the board president are required to have bonds. We get those every year. The other step of it is we're required to record those at the county clerk's office. This year, with their hours, with our craziness, we didn't record those at the county clerk's office. They recorded the ones this year. They recorded the year before and prior years. It's not a big thing. It's on here as something that they can say to us that we need to do better, and we do better. That's the only things we had. So I'm very pleased.
And I know I signed it.
Right.
I knew
we're covered.
You knew we had covered it.
It's just one of those. It's just kind of like these bids that we have. We're required to record those bonds, performance bonds, and that sort of thing for the construction projects. The work's done. We're just required to record those. So that's just what was missing on that. And there's a good reason for it. I don't think you're going to. I hope I don't lose my job over something like that. If not, I'll find other one. Thank you. That's all that I have.
Okay. Thank you. So, board members, are there any questions as it relates to the audit report?
I just want to thank your whole staff, because, and I've told you this before, I'm amazed that since I've been on here, of how much is done and the knowledge that you guys have. So, thank you.
Thank you. And I'm going to say something because I do it all the time. I always compare our office to like a swan on the water. We look like we got everything under control, but if you can see under the water, that's what we're doing. We're so busy up there, and that goes for the special ed finance staff, the Title I finance staff. I mean, it keeps us on our toes. All this money is wonderful for a lot of people. It's a lot of work for the people that have to deal with that. So I just wanted to thank you for that, because they deserve it.
Absolutely.
I just want to, I never have a question, but I just want to congratulate Mr. Lancaster and his staff for another job well done again.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Mr. Yeager.
And, you know, we are so lucky and blessed because other counties have financial problems, and we just don't. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Yeager.
Is there a motion then to accept the audit report?
So moved.
It has been moved to accept the audit report. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Has been moved and properly seconded to accept the report. Again, are there any last questions as it relates to the report? Not hearing any, all in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. The next item on our agenda then is the board member committee reports. Are there any tonight? I don't Do we have anything from MOVT or?
No, sir.
And we're still waiting on for policy. Committee's still waiting to get the next batch of materials.
I have a question on that. Is there any way that the people and the directors or whatever could look at some of these policies before the lawyer can get to it so we can at least get moving on it?
We already have for that section. And she's getting very close to being finished, but she's in personnel hearings across the state. Yeah. Rifts and transfers.
But it's just, I just feel like it's...
Right, you know, yeah.
We're not getting much done.
I don't have any other board member committee reports then. The next item on the agenda then is the other items and the discussion of policy 2322, which is the accountability piece of West Virginia policy. So, Mrs. Wells.
Yes, sir. Assistant Superintendent, do you have anything tonight?
Just, I guess, heads up here. April 14th, I'll be dragging Mr. Houston and myself to Glenville State. I'll be going to the career fair there that day. April 19th is going to be a busy day, so I'm glad you chose May for us to gather up survey information. So that's when we'll be bringing the RIF transfers and all that to you, as well as probationary employees and step-ups for the following year. We'll need approved that night. And then the other item in regards to, you have one in front of you there, one of the new calendars. The only change that the state pretty much mandated on us was Election Day, December 16th, which we had listed as an election day, is now changed to an O day. So it's an out-of-school day, not OS, but a regular holiday for teachers because we were not allowed to have two election days. We were only allowed to have one. And that moved everything to the right, so everything got moved one day. You probably didn't even notice that, but that's what did occur there in regards to our calendar. So now we can actually move forward and get it out to everybody because it has been now approved.
So this is correct?
That is correct.
Okay.
And I just want to say, if I knew how to whistle really loud, I would be doing it right now for this calendar. This is what I've asked for so long.
We're glad we could.
Now that I'm
we waited 4 years.
Six years.
I told her that I would still keep fighting for the Andy Cooley calendar.
We're glad that Joe Beth could fix that for you.
Joe Beth, thank
I
you.
Couldn't.
Okay. Mr. Lax, do you have anything else?
No.
Mr. Vargas?
Nothing tonight.
Mr. McPherson.
A couple things, and they're all good news. Yeah. I spoke briefly like a month or so ago about the Emergency Connectivity Fund money. There's probably some people here who would love to throw some things at me for a survey we had to do. I'll wait. Maybe at least one principal that would like to strangle me with a USB cable. But I'm happy to report, because of that work, that we're going to get $675,000 and purchase 1,858 laptops that we'll be able to have around. So that work, I appreciate all the teachers and the principals and all the work they did, and that it did pay off. It turned into something, so I do appreciate that. Apparently, if I mention things at board meetings the next week, the stuff shows up, so I should talk about other things that haven't shown up that we're waiting on. We're starting to get some of the gear that goes with our Wi-Fi upgrade. Several pallets of switches have showed up, so I'm excited about that. We're about a year behind on when we thought that was going to happen. So hopefully by when we come back to school next year, everything will be upgraded, and I'm excited about that. And then this other thing is a weird thing that's come into my world since September. Somebody said the word normal earlier, and I thought of this when an email I sent out this afternoon in a reply to what the mitigation secretary sends out every day, where it sends out our numbers, and I send a thing back that takes a look at the daily attendance. And we've been comparing that daily attendance rate to our pre-COVID average, and anytime it was more than twice, we had to, you know, be worried about what it was. We had three schools, and I think it's been almost a week, that three schools have been better than the pre-COVID mm-hmm. average, and the county is almost to the pre-COVID average.
Yeah.
So the word normal can almost be used. I shouldn't say that either, but here we are. So I just thought since September, every day I pull that, look at it, and it's been neat to watch it. And Jessica's doing, she keeps track of it. She does a new update every day. And of course, I know that stuff goes on a different website now, and I'm thankful for that because I used to have to post that too. But it's, you know, we actually have a somewhat of a return to, in some cases, a return to better than normal at three of our schools, and really close to normal at all the other ones, and the county average really close to where we were before COVID. So
really good news. Thank you. Mrs. Staniford.
The only thing I have is Energy Express. We do have dates June 21st through July 29th. It will be held at Payton City High School and Long Drain School. And we've sent out forms to parents for anybody that's interested in attending. We've got several back, so Payton City looks pretty full already. Long Drain's on its way, so we should be in good shape.
Excellent. Thank you. Mr. Ditto, you've already talked. Are you good? As far as accountability goes?
We had a meeting with McKinley last week for the feasibility study at Magnolia for the cafeteria. They've got their plans. They're starting to do programming on that one. We met on the bus garage. They came out, did some measuring. They're starting the programming on that one, trying to see what we can fit, what we can't fit. The new dust collector system at Magnolia is starting tomorrow. Everything was delivered Friday. Talked to Patrick about the Payton City job. He said he's anticipating next week or the following week for a pre-construction meeting on that job to get that going. All the bonds have been submitted. Talked to that, working on contract. Other than that, we're good.
Thank you, Jamie. Mr. Houston.
Just say that Wednesday's a big day. It's SAT day in Wetzel County. So hopefully we'll do well, and you know, everyone will be there, and we'll get this out of the way. It's a big deal. I was at a CTE meeting last week in Charleston, learned a lot of good information. This afternoon I had test training for three elementary middle schools for our summative assessment for them, and Long Drain on Friday morning. I just need to take care of things in high school, get them squared away, and we'll be ready for testing. I'm going to wait till Payton High School takes care of the SAT on Wednesday before I kind of roll into that. And also, I was thinking about the TSA that Mrs. Wells mentioned, because I was there Friday afternoon, and I kind of calculated numbers. Hunter High School had 20% of their students participate in that TSA contest, which is pretty awesome.
A fifth of the students, that's amazing.
You know, and then you go back to who they lost to, first place. That school had at least 1,400 more students than they did. So it's a big honor.
It's a huge honor.
And tomorrow morning, Mrs. Wells and I are going to be at Valley High School for the Capstone mm-hmm. Project, entrepreneurship that's going on with Valley High School students in the business classes, Mrs. Morshman. Also, we're fine-tuning our innovation showcase that's going to take place at Magno High School on May 5th. That's a competition between our four high schools. And first place school gets $1,500. So we'll have judges from EQT, Education Alliance, Wetzel Chamber of Commerce. Mrs. Wells is a judge. Nice if we have a board member that'd be
really
judge
nice.
That I'll work on that.
Yeah.
But it's a big deal. Each school will be allowed to have up to three projects. We'll start at 9 a.m. Should be a pretty good morning. So that's all I have.
Thank you very much. Mrs. McPherson.
Thank you. I'm going to start with child nutrition. I spoke last meeting about waivers, and I did misspeak. They actually expire the end of this school year, so our last day of school will be the last day that these waivers will be in place, not June 30th, as I had said previously. However, there is a Senate bill that has been introduced, I believe it was introduced the last day of March, 3979, called the Support Kids Not Red Tape Act. And it was co-sponsored by Senator Manchin, and it's considered the last effort, our last chance to get waivers passed. That would allow us things such as non-congregate feeding and some changes to the meal patterns. So just kind of waiting and watching to see what truly happens with all of that. Switching hats for a moment, going to talk about the center. We completed tours for all 8th graders and 10th graders. Today was the last round of tours. We polled all of those students on their career path interest, when to use that data to move forward. And we are currently accepting applications from our 10th grade students for all of our programs, and 11th grade students who may be interested in a new program in our health sciences, advanced medical preparedness. It is a one-year program. So that was something that has been requested, and we found creative ways to add a little bit more to what we have. So thank you.
Mr. Kimball.
Pretty light for me right now. I'm heading to Stonewall on Wednesday to do a mentor, special education director mentor, along with look at our ADA information and work on getting a rectification plan for one of the few items that we didn't hit the spot for the ADA for this year. So.
Okay. Thank you. Is it on this list?
Yes, yes, sir.
Thank you. Board members, are there any questions regarding any of those information that was just shared with us? Any other informational kinds of questions? Not hearing any of them, with the date and time set for the next meetings being April 19th, the statutory meeting, and a regular meeting at 6 o'clock, been one of those nights, 6 o'clock, and then the April 26th special budget work session at 9 a.m. on the 26th of April. Those are our next two meetings. Without hearing any other questions, I would move for adjournment.
I'll second that.
Has been moved and properly seconded to adjourn the meeting. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? We are adjourned.